as an international forum, give ample evidence of the force and the genuineness with which she could project various problems concerning the overall welfare of mankind with full sense of justice, equality, and sincerity of purpose. Ladies and gentlemen, GL Bajaj Group of Institutions commenced its journey to promote higher education in the year 1997 at Mathura in engineering. Subsequently, it spread its wing in pharmacy, dental science, teachers' education, architecture, and management. GL Bajaj Institute of Management and Research was founded in the year 2007 for imparting 2-year full-time course in management recognized by AICT. At present, the group has 7 institutions, more than 800 full-time
in fulfilling expectation of my profession. I duly and sincerely undertake that I shall maintain total integrity, exhibit tolerance, uphold ethical practices in accordance with the rule of sustainable development. The cause of my alma mater and support to its student managers shall always be a matter so that the profession continues to grow and contribute to the well-being of all the stakeholders and the society.
First, I would like to invite the first 3 position holders of batch 2008-10, which will be followed by toppers in each area of specialization. The first position holder for the batch 2008-10 is Manisha Kumari.
And I pray this good work continues as long as we can. I must also congratulate the young students who have received their awards today and the certificates. And more particularly, I'm sure the parents must be proud of their awards, even as they see them receive their certificates and their awards. But having said that, and even as I congratulate the students, I must remind them and all those students seated before the dais that they must be conscious of the growing role and importance of our country, India, in the emerging world market scenario today. The term emerging markets was coined by the World Bank almost a quarter of a century ago, but I think it came into great use from the mid-1990s. And from a handful of economies which probably were in East Asia, today the circle has expanded to include countries like even Latin America and Brazil. The big countries like Brazil, India, Russia, China are among the largest emerging markets today, which are expected to become world giants. And they also, even as we recognize their importance in the global scenario, they will also have to assume global responsibilities in the global context today. This means that the rules of the games must be evolved or developed in such a way that these countries cannot be neglected or marginalized anymore. Not so long ago, the former Prime Minister of Australia, Mr. Kevin Rudd, had emphasized that no longer can issues and challenges be discussed only in the G8 countries, but they must be discussed in the group G20. And the reason being that G8 does not have representation from India and China, whereas G20 does. And this only emphasizes the importance of these two countries.
One of the two world giants, and I must emphasize that this giant with a 1.1 plus billion population is still very young and is growing. According to the United Nations projections, it is said that India might even overtake China when it comes to population. But along with this increase in population, we do see rapid urbanization happening. And today, out of the ten largest metropolitan areas, we have seven situated in the emerging markets itself. Not only in the real GDP per capita in the last 10 years. The integration of the emerging markets into the world market, four companies among the world's 20 largest in terms of market value originate from the emerging markets. Two oil and gas firms, one in Russia and one in China, rank in the top 10. Moreover, according to Forbes, 7 out of the 20 richest individuals in the world come from the emerging markets, and we have 3 from our country alone. The number of millionaires in terms of US dollars and or euros is expected to be around 80,000 in India. This was in 2005. However, this is not to turn a blind eye to the fact that there is disparity which exists between the haves and the have-nots. When our Honorable Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh was in Japan, he at a press conference had emphasized that India needs development fast, and she needs it very fast, but this is not to underestimate the fact, and he laid the emphasis on inclusive growth. And that trends look very promising for the emerging economies. The future, we must admit, seems much, much brighter. The projections for long-term growth based on demographic trends and models of capital accumulation and productivity tells us that emerging markets are likely to become even more weightier in the global economy tomorrow than they are today. These, I must admit, are very speculative, but they do give us an insight into the future trends. India, together with Brazil, Russia and China, it is said, could be half the size of today's six largest industrialized economies. But the prophecy is that they could overtake the six largest industrialized economies by the year 2050. Looking ahead to 2050, China could be the world's largest economy and India could be the third, next only to the US, 21st century. They had emphasized, I think this bold and confident prophecy comes in the wake of several other international surveys that have emphasized the same. And barring a few upheavals in these two countries, it is a fact they emphasize that these two countries will become nations to reckon with in the future. Has been steadily traveling towards a higher GDP growth, and today we have a sustained GDP growth of 8%. And therefore, I don't think these countries can ever be ignored in the near future. This journey towards becoming a super economic power has been the result of certain conscientious decisions that have been taken both in the social and in the economic arenas. Some of these signposts in the journey have been spectacular. We have become the world's largest producer and also consumers in a variety of industrial and agricultural products. Many Indian companies today are winning international recognition for their manufacturing excellence, and in information and technology, India is a country to reckon with.
That our group has in various functions, specializations, synergies with each other to form set of values for which we now stand and which have been the cornerstone for our progress. Power of knowledge is now acknowledged to be stronger to all the powers. Quest for knowledge brings students to our doors. We encourage these students to live after their dreams and help them to realize this dream. Our endeavor is to create eternal learners who shall gather knowledge as they proceed and live their life. We are overwhelmed today to have amongst us the Honorable Minister of HRD, who represents the aspiration of all those who are in academics and who sets the goal and the path of developing human resources, which we claim in ourselves. The guidelines we shall receive from her today and the blessings that will be showered to those who are graduating will be a milestone in our path of progress. I am sure that when in future we look back to this day, this shall emerge a red letter day when we redeemed our pledge taken at a time when we established the first institution. I am thankful to Honorable Minister and each one of the individuals who have put their steps together with us in our march to fulfill our dreams.